a little over 10 years back, Freeman Dyson wrote an article about our biotech future. In this, he was referencing the computing revolution that had just happened at that time, right? So the initial computers that we built were these large, very unwieldy beasts that took a lot of people to manage. But today, things are very different, right? And so everyone of us carries in our back pocket a little computer that is far more powerful than anything that was there even 25 years back. And the and because of this domestication, of this commonplaceness of having these kinds of computers with us, a huge number of different applications have become possible, which would have not even have been conceived of at the initial stages when the computers were being designed and made. Similarly, Freeman Dyson anticipates that biotech will also become very commonplace. And when it becomes very commonplace, there will be a number of innovations that will happen in our homes, in our kitchens, in our garages, because we'll have access to this kind of technology. And so he envisions a day where children will make new kinds of organisms that are of different colors. So essentially, you've now begun to build new genomes. And when you've begun to build new genomes, it is no longer just about the science, it is also an art. Because you're not necessarily looking to find out something fundamental, but you're just looking to create something interesting, which may or may not have any value. Now, if you think of it from that perspective, then what do we need in order for such a thing to happen? What we need is the ability to manipulate DNA. And we've become very good at manipulating DNA. So at the around 2000, working from many different countries, our scientists published the first version of the human genome. We had learned how to read the DNA, right? We've always known how to write DNA, though we can write only small bits and pieces of DNA, and it's a little bit expensive, but we've always been able to write DNA. Now, we also have extraordinary ability to copy DNA. I mean, it's really no different than taking a piece of paper down to your Xerox machine. Copying DNA is really that simple and that easy, right? You can copy it in huge amounts with very high fidelity. But what is missing is the ability to edit DNA. And why would you want to edit DNA? Think of the cell or life as a running program, right? And something goes wrong, you want to fix that program. Or you want to use that cell to do something slightly different. So if it were a regular computer program, what would you do? You just pull up the source code, go make an edit, recompile if you have to, and run it. The equivalent of that in a cell is to be able to go in, take the DNA, piece of DNA, change whatever you need to change, and then let it go back to functioning normally or to doing something very new. And so that's clearly why you need DNA editing. And there have been a number of technologies that have been developed to do this, beginning in the late 80s, mid-90s, so to speak. And of these, two of these technologies are really quite mature, one called zinc finger nucleases and another called TALEN. And these technologies are actually mature enough that there are now clinical trials underway that utilize these technologies to cure certain very hard-to-cure genetic disorders. But what has really gotten people excited is CRISPR-Cas. And CRISPR-Cas uses what is inherent to bacterial systems, where they already have this happening in their systems, takes that and applies it to other systems. And why are people really excited about this? They're really excited about it as one, because it's really cheap. Two, it's really easy to do. And thirdly, it's simply very, very fast compared to the older technologies. So what is the problem you're trying to solve when you're editing DNA? You're saying, where do I have to cut? And how do I cut? What happens is the CRISPR-Cas system has something called a guide RNA. The guide RNA takes the cutting system, the scissors, and places it at the right position. And once it is at the right position, the cutting can happen. Now, when you cut a cell, what you're doing here, as is shown here, is a double-stranded DNA break, right? You have two strands of DNA, and you've introduced a break. The cell panics. The cell panics because it knows, in the absence of a full-fledged DNA, it'll die. And so the cell then tries, cell repair mechanism kicks in. And it brings these two pieces of DNA together. Now, it can do one of two things. It can either anneal those ends and make a whole DNA. Or remember, we all have two copies of the DNA, right? One that we got from our father and one from our mother. What it can do is the cell machinery, supposing the father's DNA has been cut, it can look at the mother's DNA, use that as a template, and copy that over. And so it can restore the DNA and repair the DNA, right? Alternatively, we can also try to cajole the cell into inserting arbitrary pieces of DNA that we want inserted in there. However, this does not always happen with high enough fidelity, and we'll come back to that momentarily. So what do you do with this kind of technology, right? And so if you look carefully at the picture behind, you'll see that there is a little child, and it might not be very visible in this picture, but he is actually sitting in a plastic bubble. So this is David Vetter. He was born with a severely compromised immune system. That means he could not live outside because the first infection would prove fatal. So he spent his entire life living in a plastic bubble while a treatment was being worked out for him. But unfortunately, by the time the treatment was worked out and he was given that treatment, he succumbed to it. But fortunately, today, children born with such highly compromised immune systems do not have to go through what David did. A simple blood test at birth can alert us to the situation, and you can do a bone marrow transplant, bone marrow replacement, and rescue those children. But this again does not work all the time, because very often some kids will reject the transplant coming from another donor. And for those cases, one might want to think of DNA editing. And what does one think of in those cases? You can take cells from the child. Okay, this is the child's own cells. And there is a technology which got the Nobel Prize in 2012 called induced pluripotent stem cells. So you can take these cells, convert them into stem cells. And in those stem cells, you can now go make edits, right? Using this DNA editing technology to remove the deleterious mutations. You can now mature these cells into the full-fledged cells that they need to be, and you can now then transplant, give it back to the child. At that point, you have now taken the child's own cells, fixed them, and put them back in, at which point it has a higher chance of being accepted. A similar strategy can also be used in other cases, like when you need new organs. And so you can take stem cells from the person, edit them, grow full-fledged organs, and then you can give it back. So it is your own organ grown for you outside and transplanted in. So we are doing some of this kind of work in collaboration with scientists at UC Berkeley and UC San Francisco, and we'll have hopefully more to say about this in the future. That was a case of curing something that was wrong. But as the adage goes, prevention is better than cure. How do you stop this from happening in the first place, right? So you can think of one of two ways of doing this. One is, at the stage of the, if you know that the parents, either the father or the mother, has a particular mutation, you can screen embryos. You can screen embryos and see if there are mutations in them, and then you can go edit them out using this CRISPR technology, but it would have to be done at the embryo stage, right? Alternatively, you can take a completely different way and say, I know the father's, this, let us assume it's a father, has this mutation, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to, at the time of actually getting the sperm and the ovum to make the embryo, I'll also have this editing mechanism there in place. And it will edit the sperm so that it is now fixed of this mutation. And so the resulting embryo that will be formed, which is shown at the bottom, right from the beginning, is mutant-free. So just last August, a bunch of researchers from the US published some studies where they tried both approaches. And they were looking at a particular disease which causes the heart muscle to get very, very thick, which means if you're doing in high strenuous activities, like if you're a high performance athlete, there is a risk that you will have a cardiac arrest. And so they were trying to say, can we eliminate this mutation? And so they did this with using both ways, where you first let the embryo form, and then after 18 hours, you put the CRISPR mechanism in there, or you have it available at the time that the sperm and the womb are forming the embryo. And what they found is, in both cases, they were able to get rid of the mutation. But in the former case, where you add it after the effect, there were far many more cells of the population of embryos which were mixed. Some had the mutation and some did not. But if you looked at the other ones, the ones where it was given along with the sperm, those were completely free of mutation. So clearly it says that you should do it at that stage, which means in vitro fertilization is the way to go if you want to think about these things. But remember I said sometimes we can cajole the system into adding that foreign piece of DNA that we want? So they did that. They gave it a replacement piece of DNA to introduce into these embryos. And in not a single case was the replacement embryo included. What had happened? the embryo, the machinery that repairs it there, instead copied the template from the mother's DNA, which was healthy, into the father's. So there's an important lesson to learn here. A mother's care for the child begins at the time of the embryo. And so all of you be very good to your mothers, okay? So that's what you have to learn from this. So what we have learned is that while we are able to edit, the repair mechanism takes over on its own. And so all these fears about designer babies, where you engineer your own traits into these children, they're probably a little farther away. So we don't have to worry about them today. Maybe we can postpone worrying about them for a few more years, right? Now, there are many other applications, right? You can think of DNA editing. Agriculture is a common example. There is a well-defined fear of GM foods, and for all the right reasons. But DNA editing of this kind can be safer than that, because you don't have to incorporate foreign DNA into the cell. You just go and edit the plant's actual DNA and fix things, rather than trying to introduce some foreign DNA. And so in that sense, this kind of technology can be better. The second is a little bit more controversial, right? You know, mosquitoes are vectors for spreading various diseases like malaria and dengue and all that. What if you were able to engineer the mosquitoes so that they were no longer able to do that? So now you have essentially a bunch of harmless mosquitoes that are flying around doing their own thing, right? And so that is possible, right? Because you can go in and edit a specific set of genes, which will make it impossible now for the parasite, the malaria parasite, for example, to have the mosquito as a good enough host. But then there is a problem. You take these mosquitoes and you release them into the wild. Now there are other mosquitoes there with which these will breed. But how do you ensure that the ensuing populations of mosquitoes have a higher preponderance of these kinds of mosquitoes that are incapable of transferring things? Because if you go by normal genetic inheritance, there's a 50-50 chance, right? Two mosquitoes come together and have a baby, and 50% chance whether I transferred over the gene that allows me to interact with the parasite or not. Gene discs are a technology where you include the editing mechanism in along with the mosquito. And so at the time of the embryo formation, it edits the gene and it makes sure that the copy that allows it not to be a vector for the parasite gets created in the embryo. But this again is very controversial because we have no idea what are the consequences of doing that. We are upsetting the ecosystem. Maybe the parasite will find some other vector, or we might end up creating a new breed of mosquito that is altogether even more powerful. But these kinds of ideas exist out there. Another application is DNA computing, and unfortunately, I cannot go into much detail about this, but this is a very interesting area. Because if you take a test tube of DNA, you can have roughly 10 power 20 molecules in there. Each one of these molecules can in turn act as a processor, for example. And that is far many more processors than that are available elsewhere in terms of your regular silicon processors. So in DNA computing, you can do a lot of computing in a very small space. Right? Now, to do an equivalent computing using a traditional silicon-based computer would require lots more space and energy and so on. But the problem is the following, that in DNA computing, it's not a general-purpose computer. So the laptop that you have, you can use it to do word processing, you can go watch a movie, you can write some code and run some simulations, etc. A DNA computer is not like that. A DNA computer is more like a program. You create one for every program that you want. All right, and one of the most interesting things that has happened is a professor at University of Manchester, Ross King, has come up with a way of taking DNA molecules, editing them and converting them into other DNA molecules and copying them to make even more copies of this DNA, which can then, following a system called a two-way rule system, actually do computing. He has shown a proof of concept application of this, but if this actually gets into practice where he builds a computer, then we might be in for some really interesting solutions that come out of DNA editing. So now, back to where we started, where we had Freeman Dyson talking about domestication of this, right? Guess what? You can already go online and buy kits to do gene editing in your home. And you can buy these kits for as low as $150 or $200. You can create bacteria of different types. You can create bacteria that glow. You can take plant extracts and feed them into these systems and see if there are novel antibiotics. So really, the biotech world is exploding in a way where you're able to now do many of these experiments at home, and it will only keep growing. But that is where the note of caution comes in, and we have to think about what are the consequences of this. And this is a big problem, right? And this is a problem that luckily my generation won't have to think about, but your generation and your children will have to think very, very hard about. And so I'll just leave you with this little quote that you can read. And this is an article written by Aristotle, who's a philosopher. And he imagined a conversation with God. And he was talking about what it is that will take us as a species to go to a higher level. And one of the things was, there will come a day when all of us will have in our hands technology that can do great good, but it can also do great harm. And each individual can have that. And how we as a society deal with that will decide who we become as a species. And fortunately, unfortunately, that responsibility will fall on all of you who are part of the next generation. Thank you.